Good afternoon from the Concordia Summit. I'm excited today to interview Lili Gil Valletta. She is co-founder and CEO of Culturintel and of CIEN Plus, which she'll talk both to us about. Culturintel is a cultural tech intel firm. Why don't we start with there, actually. What is cultural intelligence? Can you tell us about your work and your mission?
Thank you. So the definition that we've created for cultural intelligence is that it is the ability to be aware of, understand, and apply cultural competence and insights into everyday business. And that hit me when I was at my corporate career at Johnson & Johnson doing global marketing, and I realized that unless you personalize your data and your insights as you look at a market size and growth, you're kind of seeing an incomplete story. And I just decided to coin it as cultural intelligence, something everybody needs in today's fast-changing world.
I love it. I love it when a badass woman coins a term. I love a badass tech entrepreneur in this space as a woman. I think that's exciting.
Thank you.
Can you tell us, you know, I know you use data analytics and AI to measure how major events have an impact and affect culture. So can you talk to us a little bit about how that works?
Exactly. So I know that a lot of people these days get scared with AI or with data and data privacy, rightfully so. I think the world's still trying to figure out what do we do with data as a new asset class and how do we protect our own, et cetera. But what we have done is actually leverage technology for good. So what that means is we've been able to create an algorithm that can scrape and mine in a responsible way every open source comment that people in an organic and authentic way volunteer everywhere. And people these days are creating so much information that reflects their insight that we can mine into that to discover barriers to healthcare, what is getting in the way of a woman maybe getting that corporate job or not, what people articulate as their top social or political issues without ever depending on a survey or a poll. So that's what we do. We take all of that information, the big data of those comments, and organize it to look at patterns in the way people feel and relate to issues. So everything from looking into the drivers and barriers to women securing capital as entrepreneurs, to current issues like how do people feel about the border wall in the United States, or a certain celebrity or politician, we can find out in a matter of minutes sometimes, which is really cool.
It's amazing. And and how is this information used? I mean, I know you probably can't talk about your clients, but what can you give examples of the way this type of intelligence is used?
So typically our clients are Fortune 500 companies, so corporations that of course wanna get the voice of the customer, or in the case of pharma, the voice of the patient, so they can discover unmet needs. So we are always using it again as data for good. But we have had the pleasure of collaborating, for example, with researchers at the Harvard Kennedy School. So Harvard Kennedy School has an entire division focused on women and advancing equity and interventions for equality around the world. And we recently actually did a report about women founders and what are the things that are getting in the way of them securing capital. Because we get 2 to 3% of venture capital or angel funding, but we are creating businesses at a rate of 5 to 1 versus the guys. So something is wrong with that picture.
Right.
So what we discovered, for example, is that effectively, you know, women are almost 2 times more negative towards the process of raising capital. But what we did, which is so cool and scary for those that may be watching, is that we not only listened to women's comments, we looked at how investors talk about women when nobody's watching. Because you're anonymous on the digital forum.
It's fascinating.
And they basically, and now we have data to back it up. We discovered that that 60% of the factors that male investors articulate about a woman entrepreneur have to do with their personality and style more so than their skill as the thing questioned. While the male founders were more evaluated in their skill or potential. Right. So what we had heard in corporate America that you're measured based on, you know, not on potential but performance today is somewhat translated into the entrepreneurial scene. So there is clearly a bias, and this is not us women just saying it. Now we have over 500,000 data points that we analyze that confirm some of these things. So those are some examples. We've done it in healthcare, also with Harvard, for barriers to breast cancer treatment, with the Stand Up to Cancer to see why people don't get enrolled in clinical trials. So the applications are endless beyond the commercial uses, and that's what I love. I want to do both commercial value, but also purposeful, you know, data use,
right,
so we can inform better decisions.
Yeah, you know, I'm very fascinated by technology that has this social good component. Mm-hmm. And I know, obviously, you work on this intelligence, and it's a product, and you have clients that use the information.
Yeah.
But is there a legacy you're hoping that you're building here? Because that's how it sounds like to me.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think the legacy is inspired by my own journey in this country. So I'm originally from Colombia, and I came to the U.S. at the age of 17 by myself. My whole family's in Colombia. And I came with a student visa, a pocket translator, because I'm that old, and a suitcase without speaking English. And to me, discovering, first of all, that as an immigrant, you can have a bicultural, bilingual advantage was the first thing that to me feels like legacy. I want everyone else to feel empowered like that. And the other thing, when I entered the corporate life before being an entrepreneur at Johnson & Johnson, for example, I realized that when you have this cultural advantage or bicultural advantage like mine, I see the world of business differently, hence the need for cultural intelligence. So my legacy really is to culturize the decision makers of corporate America. And those of us that have a bicultural, bilingual background recognize that that is a superpower. And whether we are tech enabling it with Culturintel, or redefining how campaigns and marketing plans look like, or looking at strategies in a whole new way for your corporate growth, I want everyone to feel like this is a new thing. My dream, and I'm going to declare it here in front of the Concordia folks, is that just as emotional intelligence became a thing now in everyone's textbooks, and IQ, obviously, that you have a third thing to that mix, which is EQ, IQ with CQ, what really turns you into complete, like, incredibly effective leader. So that's what we're doing, trying to innovate around that.
It's amazing. You know, I think this story is particularly inspirational during Hispanic History Awareness Month, which is this month, Hispanic Heritage Month, sorry. You are, if I'm not mistaken, Lily, you may need to correct me on this, you are the first female immigrant entrepreneur in the tech space, right?
Well, I'm at least one of the few that I have bumped into.
Yes.
As an immigrant,
here in the United States.
Tech enabling with AI. The work that we do. So yes, and we've been published and partnering with big universities, so I feel that not as something to brag about, but as something that actually puts more fuel into our pants and skirts to keep going and becoming better and helping more people along their journey.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, it was great to have you.
Thank you.
I hope you continue this mission. I know you're paying it forward for women everywhere and immigrants
trying.
As well. Thank you. And if you're interested, please go to Culturintel's website and you can see Lili Gil Valletta on Twitter as well. Thank you again for having us, for being
thank
here.
Thank you so much.